Yeah, it's good to see so many people here, considering the competition of the other sessions. But I'll just dive right in. I'm going to be talking today about Crossmark, rubber chickens and scholarly content, which is not something I normally do. But to just demonstrate, Crossref's developing this new service called Crossmark. We've been talking about it for quite a while, but we're in a pilot stage now, so we actually have a working system up and running. So I just want to go through a little background about trust on the internet and demonstrate some aspects of trust and how that led to our thinking about trust led to the creation of Crossmark as a service. So a couple of weeks ago, I needed to get a rubber chicken. I won't bore you with the details of why, but I did a Google search. I went out to this site. I found this Century Novelty 18-inch rubber chicken. Great. They've also got key rings and smaller ones. So it looks like a pretty good site, but you know, how do I know how to trust this? You know, I see the shopping cart, but I've just come from Google, and I don't really know how to trust it. But if I go down to the bottom of the page, they have a section where it says "Earning Your Trust" and "Safe and Secure." So that's a very nice little thing at the bottom of the page. So I can look at different aspects of third-party certification services that will show me, demonstrate why I should trust this site. So looking at one, VeriSign, it's a fairly big web company, and if you click on that, you go off and you get a certificate. It tells you the name, verifies the name of the site, and says that encryption and identity verified. So it's a certain technical aspect, and I can report misuse of the seal, but it's actually coming from a third-party site, so that may lead me to trust this site a little bit more. There's also BizRate, shopping.com, and that's where you can actually go off and look at what other users have said about their shopping experience on that site. So that's a couple of ways when purchasing rubber chickens that you can establish trust. Going a little bit more to real chicken and closer to our area of scholarly publishing, if I'm looking up information on a site like WebMD, they also have links to third-party services. And again, they're all slightly different. This is a certification of the privacy policies of the website. This is an industry for a site that accredits health websites. And this ENCODE is interesting because it actually is called the Health Online Network. And it's an NGO based in Europe. And it was formed by some very high-profile researchers and doctors. And actually verifies, they actually audit sites for the content itself, not just technical aspects of the shopping experience, but it says, you know, we've audited this and, you know, this is decent information, you know, this isn't just some quack website. So it's interesting looking at offline cases as well. Very common, lots of industries have third-party certification sites. So in looking at all this, we saw some need for something similar with scholarly publishing. One of the issues is that, this is a quote from Sir Tim Berners-Lee. He says the web was originally conceived as a tool for researchers who already trusted each other, so they didn't actually build any trust into the World Wide Web, and that he said that there need to be systems for trust and labeling websites for trustworthiness once they've been proved reliable sources. So he doesn't say how that would actually happen. So looking at all this, Crossref started to think about how you build trust. One of the worst ways to get somebody to trust you is to say, trust me. You have to demonstrate it. So I think publishers have done very well. Newer and old publishers have filled up their corporate brands. But more importantly, for researchers and users, it's journal brands that are important. But even journal brands can run into problems. And when there's scandal over sort of industry-funded journals, that can affect all journals, however big they are. And I think publishers, through their journals, establish trust through a registration function, certification, you know, awareness, marketing, and very importantly, online stewardship. So with Crossmark, we're trying to capture all of those things and make it more present to the user that this is the type of activity that publishers are undertaking. This issue of online stewardship is very important. A lot of people talk about the final version of an article. Now, I think that's deadly for publishers if people think the final version, you just stick it out there and that's the end of the story. Part of the publishing process, very importantly, is first the certification of the version of record. So there is a fixed version, but then there's a very important function of the online, the ongoing stewardship of that content. So if there are corrections, revisions, who has to make those changes, who decides to make those changes, it's the publisher. So the publisher, the scholarly publisher, has a very important ongoing role in the stewardship of content. So just quickly, again, a lot of what goes into that certification and registration users aren't aware of. We don't want people just to think the publisher's job is done with the final version. There are lots of versions now out there on the web, and as I've said, the trust metrics haven't been established. So this leads us to Crossmark. So I'll say I'm a researcher, and I've downloaded this PDF. This is a PDF of an article from Science. And I downloaded it 6 months ago, and now I'm going back because I want to cite it in a paper that I'm writing. Now, looking at this PDF, how do I know whether it's changed or been corrected or updated? I can go back to the website to check, but that's a little bit of a hassle probably. So the idea is that with Crossmark, a publisher would apply a logo that would certify this as a version of record. But most importantly, if I click on that logo, it actually goes out to the Crossmark servers. And as we saw with VeriSign, it actually does a pop-up box that then gives the user very important information. So it actually says this copy of the document is not current. It gives a permanent DOI link to the content itself, but it also gives information about the correction and a link to the correction. Now, to actually make this happen, it's very easy for the publisher because they're already publishing a separate and registering a separate DOI for the correction. So when the correction comes in, the records can automatically be updated in the background in the system. But we're using, again, a version term, and these are from the NISO journal article version work that was done a couple of years ago. So this has a corrected version of record, but we're also going to have a policy statement so the publisher can then say what their policy is. They can talk about peer review and that kind of thing. So from the researcher's point of view, they can click on the logo and quickly find out the status and know that there's been a correction to this article, and they can go off and verify what that correction is. Crossmarks can also apply on an HTML version. This is a BioMed Central journal, actually, of clinical trials. You'll notice it's a little bit of a different logo. We're still in pilot phase, so we have about 10 different logos we're working with to see what works best. But if I click on this logo, then similar thing pops up, but it says that, you know, this is a publisher-maintained copy, and it gives me a little bit more information because it actually tells me there's been a protocol amendment, so it tells me the type of correction that there's been. But importantly, if you see up there on the right, it also says a record. There's another tab. If I click on that, this is an area where the publisher can add extra metadata about non-bibliographic metadata about the content, and so there's the received, accepted, and published dates, and a trial registration number is there, and then you can have a little information button to send the user off for more information about that. And then licensing information, which could be Creative Commons attribution, so there could be a way to, there's been a need in the industry for a while where there's a mixed hybrid journal of the subscription and open access. This could indicate those articles that are open access. So to begin with, Crossref isn't going to define what the publisher can put in here. And so we're hoping that over time, some industry standards will develop. It could be actually indicate peer review, so it could say this was double-blind peer reviewed. If it's a trial, it might want to say that it was a randomized controlled trial, that type of information. So we see this as a way of publishers demonstrating the things that they did to ensure the quality of the article, what they did to verify it as a version of record. Another interesting thing that comes out of this is that we would have all this Crossref metadata, Crossmark metadata, and we would make it available for local link servers, SFX servers, to crawl, but also search engines potentially could crawl this. Now, this is actually working, but it relies at the moment on a browser plugin. So you can do a search, and it'll actually read the search results and actually give you a Crossmark for the Crossmark content. So that's a way of highlighting among all the different versions that are out there. It can highlight the publisher-maintained version record. We will be talking with Google. Whether they implement it or not is another issue. But this just highlights some of the potential knock-on effects. So the elevator pitch, it's a logo that identifies publisher-certified version of record. And then you click on the logo, and then you can see whether it's publisher-maintained, whether there have been any corrections, where the publisher-maintained version is, and again, other metadata that the publisher chooses to include in that content. So that's it. Very quick overview. As I said, we're in a pilot phase. We will be launching March or April of 2011. Thank you very much. Take questions.
Richard Gay from Oxford University Press. So you go to the publisher's site, you get an article, it has the cross mark on it, says it's publisher maintained copy, but it's a PDF. If I right click and save that to my own server and make it public, is there something in this sort of algorithm that then says if somebody else comes to my site and looks at that PDF and you click on the link and it says he's not the publisher maintained version?
Yeah, it's for PDFs, no, there isn't a way to do that. So the publisher would insert the logo and metadata in the PDF. When the user then clicks on that logo in the PDF, it goes off to the internet. There's no DRM or anything, so there's no way in that specific case to indicate that it's not, the publisher-maintained version, but it will always have the link to the publisher site. If it's an HTML version, there is a mechanism where the publisher can indicate in the HTML what we call cross-mark domains. So they can say, my content is only found on these domains. So with the HTML version, yes, there is an example we have where it pops up and says, we can't verify this. We recommend you go to the publisher's site because this isn't a publisher-maintained version. But again, somebody could copy it and just remove the logo. But what we hope to happen is because of the branding and because all Crossref publishers will be able to join Crossmark, that over time, people will then begin to look at it. So if somebody stripped it out, researchers may be actually looking for the Crossmark in the future as a sign that it's actually a certified version of record. But we do see it very important that you've got to click because that's the way you're going to verify it.
But presumably the PDF, if it's on somebody else's site, and you click on the logo, it will inform you if there have been any subsequent publisher corrections.
Yes, yes. So what it does is that there is a date stamp within the PDF. So when the system will know when the user downloaded it, when that version of the PDF was downloaded, and so it will then be able to say it's changed.
So stuff on PubMed Central won't have the crossmark?
That will be up to the publisher. So if the publisher agrees to maintain the version of record on PubMed Central, that could have the crossmark logo on it, but that would be up to the publisher, and the publisher would have to work out with PubMed Central that, yes, I'm going to immediately post any corrections to PubMed Central. But again, it wouldn't have to because the publisher may not want to. And that's a conversation we have to have as well. We haven't talked to PubMed Central about it. But they do have versions of record on their site. So.
What is the business model for this service? Is it free for article depending on the program or not?
No. It's going to be a small fee for each article that the crossmark gets applied to, so for each set of metadata, and it's going to be something much smaller than it's going to be like 10 cents per DOI that gets applied, and then that's for current content. Back content might be like 1 or 2 cents.
And compared with current rate for DOI, it will be less.
Yes, yes, it'll be, right now the current deposit rate is $1, and we're talking about something that's only 10% of that, 10 cents, something like that. And then no extra annual fee or anything like that.
Hi. I've got the same thing as David Tempest from Elsevier. You mentioned pre-publication during your presentation. Can this crossmark be applied from acceptance onward? Could you put it into earlier versions of articles, and every time there's changes in the publication process, could you reflect that in crossmark, or is it only version of record that you're talking about?
It's designed to be for versions of record. So whenever the publisher considers it to be a version of record, some may publish it ahead of print online and consider that a version of record, so they would apply it, but no, it wouldn't be an accepted version in those early stages. It's just the version of record at whatever point. So we're not saying publishers have to change what they do now. This is really just to go along with whatever they're currently doing.